and Simon have worked beautifully in order to put together technology and archaeological research in order to educate. And that's my mission today, trying to bring some of that research that we have done in Guatemala in order for you to understand on the importance of the Maya textile tradition, continuities and change in Maya weaving traditions. The objective of my presentation is to have a glimpse at Maya weaving and dress traditions in Guatemala from 200 before Christ to 1531. That's when we have evidence of the Spaniards beginning the use of wool in the highlands. And coming, spanning to the 21st century, these traditions have evolved over more than 2,000 years. So this is the interesting part. We're going to change the topic of the things that we have been discussing at Maya Weekend in order to connect the past with the present. For many indigenous women, weaving their identity for wear or for sale has been an integral part of their lives. Modern trends of fashion are continuously transforming traditional weaving and dress, so the Maya women of today express their ethnicity in various ways. So let's get context. We're talking about whole Mesoamerica, where many different ethnic groups were thriving. And one of the features and common elements of that culture was weaving technology and the traditions of dress. It was all based in the same technology, so we have common elements. Now, as you people are more familiar with all the archaeological findings, we know that the Maya people developed beautiful aesthetic forms of textiles, like we see these women garb in regalia for ritual occasions. We see a woman here participating in another context at the courtly regalia. And we see her wearing something that might look like the weaving that I'm wearing, a huipil woven with the pig bill technique, the white and white transparent technique that the Maya Quechi women of today still weave, but mainly for sale, because it's a survival strategy, because they are extremely poor indigenous people of Guatemala. So, although the Maya developed a high culture, pre-Columbian textiles have not survived, so their artistic legacy, ceramics, monuments, codex, is an eloquent testimony of their textile mastery. So here we see pre-Hispanic dress as an expression of hierarchy and status. We see this character from Caminal Cuyum. We see him donned with a cape that most likely was made up of bark strips, which we know that in classic times were part of the attire of warriors, especially for ritual occasions. Here we see, as interpreted by Linda Schilly and Marianne Miller, we see a couple of characters getting ready to dance, and we see them dressed with the wraparound skirt and this sarong style textile wrapping her body, and we see men with very simple garments, but beautifully decorated. And we see this male figure from the codex in which we see him dressed with a cape. We see how capes through history are going to be one of the male garments that's going to denote hierarchy through time. Here we see the elite of late classic times wore garments in which huipiles to participate in rituals of sacrifice, for example, were noted expressions of aesthetic achievement. Here we see a lady, a noble lady, with a wraparound skirt that makes us think of the modern skirt that women from the town of Patsun are wearing for everyday life if they stick to their distinctive tradition. Here we see her beautifully dressed with a very long over huipil or huipil, with designs beautifully woven or embroidered. We don't know that much about techniques from that time. And this, another beautiful garment for ritual occasions. So that's going to be one of the constant elements, the continuity of elements of how the best aesthetic achievements are made for ritual occasions. Archaeological evidence of textile production is scanty. Few examples have been found. For example, a polychrome textile from Chipti Cave, Chiapas, dated pre-contact or post-contact time circa 16th century. We see that fragment is decorated with superficial paint on cloth, reserved designs, and most likely dyeing of threads. Now we make a jump in time and we go to the colonization and conquest of the Maya people of Guatemala. That brought a dramatic change in terms of technology, especially among men. We see here some of the instruments that were introduced by the Spanish, like the cardboard, the spinning wheel, and these instruments, especially the treadle or foot loom, in which we see a woman working on it, although that's a modern phenomenon. In colonial times, up until the 18th century, we have the evidence of men working on the foot loom because that was tradition, a tradition in Spain. We see them, the Spaniards introduced the use of wool, techniques such as embroidery, as we document in the catalog, which you can purchase in this activity, and also the use of wool. This is wool that was worn as part, or is worn as part of the headcloth for ritual occasions in Misco, a village. Now, Maya ceremonial clothing in colonial and post-colonial times. From the 16th to the 19th century, we see a few samples. This lady from Hakatenango, we took this from a painting in an old document, and we see her that she has a white huipil with a little bit of red decoration, most likely produced with the cochineal dye. And the wraparound skirt, indigo dyed. And then we see a man working on the nopal cactus, working with the cochineal, but he's dressed with a very simple garment and the over pants or pants that were introduced by the Spaniards. We jump in time to the beginning of the 19th century and we see a Maya woman dressed with a blouse, a wraparound skirt, both garments of European influence, and a petticoat under her wraparound skirt. And we see this couple most likely were members of the Cofradía religious brotherhoods that were also introduced by the Spaniards, but were institutions in which syncretism took place, and they combine elements of pre-Hispanic culture and European culture. And we see again that he's dressed with a cape brought by the Spanish. Actually, it was called Spanish cape, and we're going to see how that has evolved to the present. This is a beautiful testimony that is we can enjoy thanks to the Guatemalan photographer Alberto Valdeavellano, who in 1895, he would go to the villages and he would take a photograph of Nahuala, he would take a photograph of San Juan Zacatepeques, a photograph of Patsun. But you notice that the images are cut because it's a collage of negatives that he put together in order to convey to the world that Maya culture and Maya dress is a combination of the pre-Hispanic Maya culture represented by the falling stela, and the European culture represented by the oldest temple in Guatemala City, the Cerrito del Carmen. Now, there's a question, how did this happen? We don't have good answers because historically speaking, we have gaps that we are not able to fill. My address is a topic in which chroniclers and historians of the time, like Archbishop Cortés y Larraz, they were not interested. So we don't know that much about my address, as much as we want. Okay, here we have making a jump in time. We go to San Martín, Zacatepeques, and we see men and women dressed with their distinctive attire in the 1940s. Now, we saw somebody yesterday with a San Martín, Zacatepeques dress, although nowadays, less and less men are wearing this distinctive dress because of modernization, and they used to wear a capuchin like this one, and that's almost a thing of the past, as has been documented by Matthew Looper, a great researcher. Here we have this beautiful photograph from Tomás Zanotti, 1910. We see a young woman from Totonicapán. She's wearing a headdress woven in the neighboring village of Totonicapán. This beautiful embroidered, over-colored, traditionally only worn for cofradía occasions. Her sash and her beautiful corte, or skirt, which is distinctive of this village. Now, we have another mayordomo, or cofradía official, from San Cristóbal Totonicapán, with a cape, with a suit or a special handkerchief, cloth worn on the head as a sign of his position, his insignia of the cofradía. And what do we see? Cofrade from Comalapa also wearing the distinctive cape of that it reflects his position in the highest hierarchy of the village for ritual occasions, only for a procession. So let's take a look about that cultural heritage of Guatemala. Guatemala is a very small country, almost the size of Tennessee, and we have like 13 million Guatemalans. But let's stress something that Christina in the morning stressed. These are the Maya people of Guatemala. The Maya people of Belize, they really want to make a difference. It's a different culture that she described. The Maya people of Guatemala make up around 5.7 million people. That depends on the source you're going to consult. I consult the National Statistics Institute data, who speak 23 different languages, which are represented in this map. Each color represents a different language, and you have the Quechi and the Mam, and they cannot understand each other except for some common languages in some common words in some of those languages. So it's a very rich linguistic diversity. And besides that, the traditional dress plays an important role in conveying identity, especially among women. Women have been the preservers of this tradition, and it's women who now are expressing their views about the world, this textile art. And now it's men, Maya men, who say, oh, you have been so strong about it. And sometimes they want to imitate what women have done, and they dress themselves with shirts that might have elements of identity, because they want also to convey their ethnicity through dress in a little way compared to women. So important features of Maya culture is the fact that 60% of the Maya live in rural villages, and each village had cultural autonomy until the 70s. One of the most important expressions of this was the specific style of dress which prevailed among highland communities, such as this one. We have Sunil in a beautiful valley. We have another valley, Comitancia, which we just covered in 2010. So I'm trying to convey the fact that these it has changed dramatically. But we have to have a historical reference that up until the 70s, we had great deal of differences among the villages, especially in the case of women's dress. So here, let's go back in history. There's Ixchel, goddess, patron of weaving, fertility, and the moon. And she is weaving with the backstrap loom. And that's what this woman from Huahuacatan is doing in the department of Huehuetenango, Nahuala, Solola. And this young girl from San Pedro, Zacatepeques, Guatemala, only 35 kilometers away from the city. They're using the very same instrument, a very simple instrument with which technically dexterity can allow them to produce beautiful artwork. Now, ceremonies are very important in order to understand Maya dress. As I say, the most important aesthetic achievements are associated to ritual behavior, like we see this cofradía from Chichicastenango. Some of you were there. And these male garments. You see the influence of European clothing is more strong among the men than the women. Here we have Solola, we have the contrast of everyday dress compared to ritual dress, capuchin, jacket, over pants, pants that these men are wearing for everyday, sashes, a headcloth, and there are some pieces missing. Why? Because this is a village which was very conservative, in which each garment denoted the hierarchy of the wearer of that clothing. Here we have specific style in two villages. Every day in Tecpan, you see the skirt is stuck inside the huipil is stuck inside the corte or wraparound skirt, while for ceremonial occasions she's wearing a nim pot. Nim in the some of the Maya language means big huipil. She's wearing a nim candela, a big candle, because she is dressing herself with garments that are beautifully produced, but also garments that have meaning to those people, to the members of the cofradía. Young people are sometimes not interested in the symbolism attached to those garments. Now, why do we call this festive dress? Because these are women who do not belong to the cofradías, but we see that they're wearing a headdress and the totonicapán cinta on their head because it's a special occasion. It was the festivity of their patron saint in Santa Apolonia. Now here we have Maria Neves, this indigenous woman who is dressed with an over huipil. It's hard to notice. This is on top of her everyday huipil. Now this is 2008, and this was 1910. According to the beautiful pieces that the Ixchel Museum has in Guatemala, as a historical record of all these changes. So identity does change with time. It's the women who are the creators of their identity, and they define that identity according also to the type of materials that they have available. So here we have a beautiful village. It's like paradise, like you're an anthropologist, and you're in heaven, because somehow time has encapsulated in San Juan Atitao. Why? Because it's very isolated from Guatemala City. It has more the influence of Mexico than Guatemalan culture. So you have, as we will see in some of the slides coming afterwards, men all wearing distinctive dress, and women are wearing distinctive dress. Now, this as a reference is the huipil worn in the village in the 1980s from the Ixchel Museum collection. They go to the market and have acrylic fibers in these beautiful colors, and women love it. And you walk in the streets of the village, and this is what you find. Little girls, adolescents, middle-aged women, whatever, all are into weaving. giving. This doesn't happen in other villages of Guatemala. And we have girls who are wearing also distinctive dress. The only person we saw in the village without a distinctive dress, she was the teacher of the village. She was modern. So for some days, she wore distinctive dress, and for others, embroidered blouses. Now, Todos Santos Cuchumatan is close by in Huehuetenango, and here we have a visual reference, an emblem of identity, to put it like that, 1980s, and this is what has happened lately. They love these colors. Now, Todos Santos has more connection with this country. Remember, we have an influx of migrants, and these migrants are bringing new ideas, whatever, so that you find a little bit more in Todos Santos. In San Juan Titán, as far as we could remember, there are not many migrants coming to the state, so that also contributes. Now, San Andrés Acabajá. This is a beautiful example, not many in the collection of the Ixchel Museum, 1960. This is little documented by this. It has the backstrap weaving techniques, tapestry techniques, but 50 years later, this is what the women are wearing today. It's all material, modern fabric, but it's still distinctive. And I didn't include a photograph of the beautiful Totonicapan style headdress that these women wear. So again, this is an isolated village that they are creating their distinctive patterns of dress in a very particular way. Now, look at this, Chichi Castenango and Chiche. Chiche, Chichi. Chiche share and Chichi share the same specific village dress. Why? Because the second municipio, this is Chiche, belong to Chichi. So these are migrants from this village, and so they stick to their identity style in very similar ways. So this sense of belonging to the village is still conveyed by these sister villages. Now, Sololá. Sololá is very interesting because, as I said, was very conservative until the last decade, I would say. As we document in this catalog, the women of, let me jump to the next slide. This is a traditional huipil in a shirt style of huipil, but this was beautifully produced in the backstrap loom, like the main pot of the Texel or the Cofrade member. Now, what has happened? These designs are being imitated in the machine, in the sewing machine by men. That's a big change. And these women, they love the purple, which is in fashion, or the mustard color, however you want to call it, have applied crochet flowers, which are in fashion. Now, Santa Catarina Polopo in the lake, some of you are wearing a huipil from this village, and it's interesting because three styles are coexisting today. 1960, this is a traditional style worn by this old woman, beautifully, beautiful dress. This is the second style, and a third style has emerged in the last 5 years, and women are into weaving, and they are creating these changes. Now, San Juan Zacatepeque's Guatemala, very close to the city. This is a reina. You see her headdress? It signals that she's a queen. This is a concept imported from your country, the pageant contest. So we have that in Guatemala. A generation ago at the Rabina How contest, so it has become part of their culture, and so she's the representative of her village, dressed according to the style of the cofradía. So there's a connecting thread with the past. And here she is a reina from San Juan La Laguna, and she has the same dress of the cofrades. So again, we anthropologists don't like change, but we have to accept it, and that's part of the reality in Guatemala. Now, Chuarrancho, this is the 1990s, 1980s. This beautiful dress worn by a woman for the festivity, for the patron saint's festivity. Now, other women and her daughter like to wear the atitlan, we peel with the applied maiden crochet flowers. But she's wearing another style of dress that we call panmaya. Panmaya is a concept that was coined by Kay Warren, and anthropologists like Richard Adams started to use it because it covers the idea, conveys the idea that Maya women of today are condensing identity from different villages. And in some cases, they don't care too much about identity anymore. It depends on if they're intellectuals, they're merchants, they're whatever. They will give a different interpretation to identity. So this is a style of huipil woven in the back strap loom in imitation of the cross-stitch designs. But you see a tendency for orange or red. This is a sash also done in the marcador style. And this is the generic e-cut skirt. But color has become an important element to combine garments. So this we covered in 2010, thanks to friends of the Ixchel Museum. We went to a hamlet called San Pedro Pets, which belongs to the municipality of San Pedro Zacatepeques in San Marcos. And she's wearing a huipil that the women are weaving in the treadle loom, and then they embroider it by hand or machine. So it's hard for you to notice that these are randas or the joining stitches, the flowers which are in fashion, and this is the distinctive skirt. This is, you see, now they prefer these colors, but this is kind of more like the traditional skirt, covered by this commercial cloth apron and the shela huipil, that is from Quetzaltenango. Now, what has happened to Zacualpa? When we were there in 2010, oh, it was terrible. We felt so frustrated because we traveled to this village and we thought everybody, or mainly a big group of women, are going to be dressed with distinctive dress. No. We saw only like 12, 15 women using the distinctive dress of Zacualpa. Sometimes they love the metallic thread. Metallic in not reality, it's synthetic, but they love that shiny look. But most of the women, I mean like young mothers and younger people, are into the generic style of dress because they like these blouse, it's called, originally coming from Santa Cruz del Quiché, combined with a generic sash, generic apron, generic corte or skirt. That's in fashion. Why? Because it's comfortable to work. We also have global warming effects and the economy. The economy is greatly related to this phenomena of identity. Now, we also have regional traje. I'm wearing a huipil from Coban, done in the pigbil, which is the supplementary web brocading white on white. Now, many women just go to the stores and buy this type of material, which imitates this, which is less expensive, and which is more comfortable for everyday life. And you see this very popular garment, cut and woven and sewn in the imitation of the huipil shape. And you see it everywhere in Guatemala. And we also have regional traje among the men. Like he can be from Catsum, Comalapa, or Santa Polonia municipalities. And he's wearing a shirt with a distinctive sash and a distinctive ponchito. That's the name of the apron-like woolen item that he works combined with a sweater. Now, panmaya traje, this is a huipil from Tamau combined with generic garments. This woman, Isabel, she is from Totonicapan, and for one activity at the Ixchel Museum, she was told, "You please bring your distinctive dress." No, she decided to dress completely with a Colotenango dress, because you see, Maya people have shifted in one generation or more from tradition to personal taste. Now it's al gusto, according to the taste of the wearer. So there's more liberty for women to choose what they're going to dress with. And we have the peace accord treatment signed in order to protect Maya dress. But Maya women want to have the freedom to dress themselves in a wider array. So here we have more samples of generic traje, and we have this girl, most likely from San Juan La Laguna or San Pedro La Laguna. Look at the beautiful flowers, flowers in the sash, the apron, even the shoes, more likely coming from China. China, China is everywhere. It's part of global culture in Guatemala, and that's what Maya women prefer. Now, Todos Santos, Cuchumatlan, so we have a little bit of a glimpse what happens with men. Men, in general, it will be like a dozen of villages where they still wear distinctive dress for every day. This old man from Todos Santos, which was so delighted to pose for us, and we're delighted to work with generous people like him. And also, he's the professor of the village who went this crazy woman coming to the villages and do research, and he wanted and came with us and helped us. He was delighted, and he was part of our team, let's say. Schwetzer, or however you call it, and Todos Santos pants. San Juan Atitán. All men are dressed in their specific style village. Now, the men do the crochet of the morrales, and you will find Nike crochet, because tennis shoes are very important in Maya dress. When you see the dances in Chichicastenango, what do you see? Nike, because they're Maya people adapt to changes in the matter. It's convenient for them, so it's part of their everyday culture. Or you see Tigo, that's the brand name for our cell phones. Now, San Andres de Metabaj, the last village we covered January of this year, we see this beautiful girl with that distinctive dress, this lady. But in the store, in the plaza, in the shopping mall, little shopping mall of the village, we see the marcador style with these beautiful birds, which are in fashion in purple generic sash, and the purple ikat, big ikat. And this other monochromatic fashion, we call it, because color is an important item of selection of clothes. And one of the nice things we found in Santa Maria Visitación Sololá in 2002 is that a specific style dress is an expression of local identity as conveyed in a painted mural in the plaza. And we found the painter of the mural. And he wanted to convey, this is a village project, that Maya dress is a combination, it's an evolution from pre-Hispanic times, colonial times, modern days. We even have Efraín Ríos Font here, depicted as part of our conflict war. And we see the evolution of Maya dress and how the villagers themselves want to convey identity through dress. This is ceremonial. Over we peel, every day we peel, and the men's dress, although for everyday life, not many people wear this. So, identity is a fluid and dynamic sociocultural construction, especially in 1970s. An expression of these are traditional and modern styles of dress which coexist, community-specific and modern, Pan Maya and generic, which is the general trend nowadays. And the future of Maya dress as a mirror of identity will be transformed by its wearers, depending in the influence of fashion, globalization, poverty, climate change, among other factors. The future is in the hands of the Mayan people, because also we have to bear in mind, as we said, identity has price. Many poor Mayan people cannot afford to wear a distinctive dress because it's very expensive for them. So here is field research, kind of a summary, ethnographic surveys undertaken during 13 years, 58 villages covered, mostly sponsored by Friends of the Ixchel Museum, also Daniel Agostino Foundation, United States Embassy of Guatemala, This is San Juan Atitán, Todos Santos. She was mocking at me. She said, if you were young here, you would never get a boyfriend. Why? Because you don't know how to weave. See? Angela, the photographer that travels with us. Violeta, part of the team in Quetzaltenango, documenting embroidery. And this is San Andres Cebetabaj, the last village. And what is important is that I really appreciate this opportunity to convey identity and my address, which is a topic that in many cases Guatemalans are not interested in. They take it for granted. So thank you, Bantosh, as we say, and thank you for your attention.